Okay, hello everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Hans-Jürgen Schönig. Just call me Hans, it's easier maybe. I'm over there from Europe. You might heard of the country of Austria, maybe once in a while, which is roughly here. So I'm glad to got the invitation to come here to the conference to talk to you about some small amounts of data and how to scale, I would say, Postgres up a little bit. So I'm delighted that the room is somewhat full. Is everybody somewhat comfortable with my accent or? Okay, guys, so this is about 1 billion rows per second. And the second slide is a bit boring. It says it's reaching a milestone. It's a bit pathetic. Basically, this whole thing got personal. I was attending a GPU conference in Amsterdam, and every minute somebody was walking by and asked the question, can you scale? And at some point you start to be angry, right? Because every time you get this bloody question, can you scale, right? What do you say? Yes, no, maybe, don't care, go away. You know? So I looked up some stuff on the internet and I stepped over some Oracle paper where Oracle announced and bragged 1 billion rows per second. So as I told you, it was a bit personal from this point on. So we decided to, what can we do actually to do the same thing in Postgres, right? So what does it take to process 1 billion lines per second in Postgres? I mean, if you can do 1 billion lines, you can do 5 billion lines, you can do 10 billion lines, you can do 100 million lines, right? So the question is really, what can be scaled? How can it be done? How do you do that? And what's the current state of the project in order to achieve that? So first question for the audience, who is more than 1 billion rows? Okay, how much more? Give me a number. 5, 10? Trillions, okay, that's nice. We only know that from government debt home in Austria. So trillions is usually. Okay. So, as I said, the goal is processing 1 billion rows and see what's the path to get there. Silence the discussion about, hopefully, about scalability, at least to some extent. And basically, the next important thing is to figure out where are the limitations in Postgres. So where do we need to improve? Where do we need to do things better? And secondly, how can it be done without any commercial tools, without any data warehouse, without any hyper fancy, whatever stuff? So use as much vanilla Postgres as you can and see how far you get, right? So, word of caution. I gave this talk 2 weeks ago in Moscow, and somebody approached me, but it doesn't work for every query. Of course it doesn't. this is a, if you have this amount of data, doing everything is not what you're aiming for, right? You're trying to solve the problem you got, but given a certain amount of data, everything is sometimes harder than it sounds, right? So if somebody promises that, oh, we can do everything at this speed, that's most likely a lie or a marketing guy or something like that, okay? Which could be equivalent, I don't know, okay? So, as I said, it's a path to enlightenment, if you know what enlightenment is. So. Okay, so, as you might know, many years ago, back in the old days, that's where I come from, we used to have one core for each query, which means that if you have a large amount of data, and if you do this with one CPU core, you're always somewhat limited, because the ability to build ever faster single core systems is basically, I wouldn't say gone, but it starts to be harder and harder to get stuff out of a single core. So obviously what you want is you want to use many cores. And starting with Postgres 9.6, we got the ability to use a parallel query. And as you might expect, we're gonna use that. Okay? So that's the basic idea. Basically, that's not the first time in Postgres history that somebody tried to do a lot of data. Traditionally, back, I think it was 12 or 13 years, something like that, a brilliant guy from Skype had the idea to use to build a thing called PL proxy, which is an ingenious concept because the idea is to have a stored procedure language whose only purpose is to scale. You call a function, it does all the nasty stuff, it dispatches spreads the query all out in your cluster, and it's wonderful for OLDB stuff, at least back in the old days. But the problem is you have to do everything yourself. So the question is, if you have 50 servers, you have to do anything yourself, you don't want that. So the question is really, how can we do that? You issue a query, you get an answer, no strings attached. Okay? So that's the whole plan for that. Any questions regarding scope, etc.? So by the way, there are some seats over here in case you want to be more convenient. Okay. Okay, so 1 billion rows. We've decided on a fairly complicated table consisting of three columns only. And this is going to be the data, how to approach that. Basically, you have to keep one thing in mind. It makes no difference if you have three columns, 50 columns, 500 columns. I mean, if you have more columns, it's going to be slower, right? How do you counter slowness? Well, you add more capacity, okay? So if people criticize the fact that my table is reasonably simple, the only reason was to do it that in such a simple way is that we didn't want to render out so many machines. Okay, that's the only reason. But imagine you had the same thing with 50 columns. Okay, so for the general strategy of what to do in order to get there, it makes no difference if there are 3 columns or 9 columns. Right. So it's basically, technology-wise, it's the same thing, right? It's just boiled down to a minimum example in order to see where we can get here. The query we tried to do, of course, we did some more queries, but you will see along the way all the implications we got here in order to make it work. So very simple query. We have a couple of groups. We count it, and then there's a demo table. And so one counter per group, so simple analysis. That's basically, I mean, that's a pretty common thing, actually. You have if a reasonably large size, you could calculate count, average for a couple of groups. You could add a couple of filters. You could do all these kinds of stuff, right? So that's a fairly common type of query, I would suggest. But again, as a word of caution, it's the most simplistic example I could think of to get there. In reality, you're going to have broader tables, you're going to have some more filters, you're going to have some other data types, etc. But it makes no difference. The point is, if this makes a difference, then something is wrong by definition anyway. Okay. So before we start scaling out, we get to see how much can we actually get out of a single server? Because if we know how far we can get on a single server, it's going to show us the path of how much hardware we are supposed to throw at the problem in order to reach this kind of goal. Right? So single server performance, how far can we get with a single server? How far can we get with a single machine? And how far can we get there? So, as you know, or as you might know, or as I hope you to know, in Postgres, parallel queries were added in 9.6. Of course, it's not feature complete. Nothing is ever feature complete. So features are added as we speak. And for the test, as I said, it's basically Postgres 9.6 with some extensions I'm going to talk about in a couple of minutes. So, one thing when you're using parallel queries in Postgres is that if you fire a query, the system is going to determine the number of CPU cores it's going to use. And the reason is quite simple. If you have 30 cores, if you're alone, you might want to use them. But if there are more people working on the system, you don't want one guy to take all the resources, right? So obviously, we have to plan for more people on the same system, which makes somewhat sense. And that's pretty much exactly what I did not want. I wanted to be alone, you know, I'm a greedy person, so I wanted to have all the resources, right? So Postgres basically determines the number of CPU cores it uses for a scan by using this variable called min parallel query relation size, and by default it's 8 megabytes. It means that if you have a 4 megabyte or a 3 megabyte table, Postgres is never going to go for a parallel query because it's not worth setting up the infrastructure. It's just not worth doing that. So if your data is small, Postgres is not going to go for a parallel query. What happens instead is if the size of a table triples, you will get one more worker. Okay? So if your table is 9 times larger, you will get 2 more worker processes. Okay? So there's basically a formula here which says, okay, take this value, and if you multiply it by 3, you will get 1 more worker. Unfortunately, I did my test with 3 billion rows, and you cannot set this value large enough to get all the CPUs to work. Right? So fortunately, you can overrule the thing. So you could say, alter table on the demo, set parallel workers to 32. So you can explicitly tell the system, okay, if you're doing a large scan on this table, use all the hardware you got. Okay, so I'm throwing everything at processing a single table, because if I keep using this standard setting, I tried it with, I think, 100 kilobytes, and it never gave me more than 13 cores or so, because if you do the math, you cannot set it low enough in order to use 500 CPU cores or so. So basically, you have to cheat a bit and tell the system, okay, guys, we are alone. Let's use all the hardware. It's party time. We really want to cook the main board, right? So that's what we did. So basically, putting it all together. The question is, we did the whole test in memory. And that comes for a very simple reason. Because you wanted to figure out how Postgres scales and not how your storage system scales. Okay? If you got a single SSD, it's going to give you, let's say, 400 megabytes a second. And guess how far you get with 400 megabytes a second. On my private box at home, in some cases, it's not even enough to fill a single CPU core. Okay? So Intel CPUs or Power8 or whatever you got is so powerful that you really get into trouble with such simple queries to feed the thing. Okay? So of course you can add more servers, you can stick 50 SSDs into your disk, into your box, but at some point, if you want to know how Postgres scales for the sake of simplicity, we did it in memory. And that's not necessarily realistic, but the only thing it does, if you do it in memory, is that you need fewer boxes. Because otherwise, what you do is you just keep adding servers. So what's the point? I mean, once you're linear, you don't care if it's 10 or 12 servers. The question is, can you be linear up to a certain number of servers? So that's the real question. Okay, so don't be shocked if everything here is in memory, because you would see exactly the same behavior with simply more disks or something like that. So we did not want it to be a disk benchmark, for the sake. And this is what's going to happen on a single server. Okay, so we rented out the largest box we could get on Google for the staggering price of 28 euros for the whole test. Okay, so it's highly expensive. It's roughly a speeding ticket at home. Yeah, I know that. They paid some of them. In Germany, they have those wonderful white, round signs on the highway. It means do what you want. That's freedom, right? German car, good thing to have. I've seen some on the road. So basically, if we start off with one CPU here, we are somewhere down here, and as we keep adding worker processes, right? So up to here, we added 16 worker processes, and the important observation here really is that's a linear thing, okay? So if there is no I/O limitation, let's suppose it's only memory. What Postgres actually gives you is a linear line for a sequential scan, group by, things like that, if you add more cores. Okay, if you add more workers. That's highly important, because if the line would go like this, then you would have a hard time if your table gets larger or something like that. So you don't want that. So you really, really want to be linear here. And what you see here, everything above 16, if you add workers, This is Intel hyper-threading. Okay? So Google rents out a 32-core box. In reality, it's 32 threads. It's 16 cores. Took me 2 hours to figure out. Okay, so everything you see up from this point is that you see that this, we call it jitter, is that the right English word? Is gonna increase, and that's the impact of hyper-threading. Okay, so it could be, you see the variations go up. So, but basically linear to hardware capacity. That's the main observation. And what you see here is that we top out somewhere in the area of 30-something million, okay? 35, 40, depends on how lucky you are. But that's roughly something you get out of a machine on Google. By the way, as you might have noticed before, what I did was I did count data and not count star. There's a semantic difference and also a performance difference. If you put in star, you will see a couple of million more. Okay? So there is a difference here between count star and count data. But basically what it does is it shifts the curve up by a couple of million. So we don't care. Okay? The reason is I was too lazy to write the aggregate we need here. That's the only reason why this is count star. Not count star. But basically this is hyper-threading, which is somewhat interesting. So we see here that we are at 30-something million. So if we do the math, we can go for 30 servers and see what happens here. So, as I said, 16-core box, and everything provided for the staggering amount of €28.14 from Google Compute Engine. And, yeah. So, of course, we want to have more than one node, okay? So having one computer is somewhat boring. Even your neighbor has that. You want to be better than your neighbor, of course. So what we did was we placed, in order to stay in memory and all this kind of nasty stuff, what we did here is we put 100 million lines on each shard. Okay, so generating 100 million lines and putting it all on a shard, which basically means that you stay in memory. Okay, so a line of this size is something like 30 bytes or so, or 35, whatever. And basically here it fits nicely on one shard, so disk bottleneck is basically limited. And of course, on every shard, parallelize the hell out of it, okay? So everywhere, maximum workers, which means 32 servers, 16 core each, leaves you with roughly 500 cores, and that's basically what it takes in a virtual environment to do that. I'm gonna elaborate on the number of cores a bit later again. Okay, so this is what it looks like, of course. You have a server, and this is where your query ends up. And what you do here is you create a table, and what we decided on, the easiest way to do that in 9.6 is basically to have a partitioned table, but every partition is a foreign data wrapper to the other box. Okay? So here I got an empty table with 32 partitions, and each partition is a foreign table. Okay? So if you have a single table on this server, you shard it as much as you want, and then on all the nodes, you have all the data we got here, but here it looks like one table and it's partitioned. So if you query that, suppose we have two nodes only in our system, which is of course not sufficient, what we got here is we scan every table, and for every table we want that the aggregation is gonna happen on the other side. The key here is that if you start sending data around, don't even get started. Okay, if you want to send 3 billion rows over the network, don't get started, right? No way to do that in 3 seconds. I mean, no way meaning no useful way. Okay, I mean, if you're some large company, sending gigabytes of data over the network is okay, but this is a single database installation, so you certainly don't want to exchange data because you can't afford it, because you need all the time in order to compute something. You cannot send it over. So the key here is really to push this aggregation over. So The count is going to happen on the other side 32 times, okay? And at the end of the day, it has to be added up. And here is the first crucial thing. How do you make the thing push over the aggregate? That's not so trivial, actually. And then you just add up the numbers. But then you get, I went for 10 groups, so 30 times 10 groups. So the final stage here is something like 300 rows, so it's not even worth thinking about that. So the real party really starts if you manage to push over the aggregate. And that's not trivial, okay? That's not trivial. Okay, as long as the partial results are comparatively small, this is going to be somewhat linear, okay? So if we do that on a million groups, so if you got a million groups here, the situation is going to change because you have to fetch all those intermediate results and process them, right? So you can really only guarantee linear scalability if the intermediate results are somewhat small, okay? Have I missed anybody so far? Is everybody sufficiently enlightened, or did I lose anybody already? Anybody asleep? No? Is your neighbor asleep? No? Everybody looks fine. Okay. So we scale up to a billion rows. So of course it takes a bit. And the first thing you have to keep in mind is that if you use a foreign data wrapper, the bloody thing, well, the wonderful thing, uses a cursor behind the scenes. It has to. Because it has to assume that if this is a database link and you fetch over all the data, you have to assume that it's a lot of data, so it uses a cursor. And the trouble is, it's not so much an issue for this kind of query, but it's an issue for different queries, that if you do that, in Postgres, there's a thing called cursor tuple fraction, which tells the optimizer, don't optimize for the whole result. Optimize for the first 10%. Okay? So you do declare cursor for select star, and it doesn't optimize for the whole thing. It optimizes for the first 10%, assuming that you're not going to read the rest. And that's a bit of a problem because it changes the plan. Okay? It changes the plan, which is not an issue in this case, but it has some impact on how things work. Okay, so easy part, tell the thing, do it all at once, just to be sure all the plans are fine, no bad assumptions, get it all at once, don't interact, we don't want to talk to you, do your work, send the answer, shut up, okay, everything is fine. So that's the first thing, that's somewhat easy, because it's there, okay. Next on the list, we have to make all those people work at the same time. So we cannot say, okay, you do 100 million lines and we wait for you, then comes the next guy, let's wait for him, then comes the next guy, we wait for you. We don't want that, because then we would be sequential and there is no point in sharding an aggregate if you do all the stuff in a sequential way. There's really no point. So what you want here is, if we go back to the query, all those parts here have to work concurrently. And at this point, Postgres 9.6 cannot do that because it simply has not been implemented. That's the point. So, fortunately, there is a bit of traffic on Postgres mailing list, and there are patches around to make this happen for future versions of Postgres. And we did that. So we took the stuff and patched it in, and everything is fine. And then you need a second thing. You need asynchronous fetching. So you want parallel append, so all the data is fetched, added up, so this has to be in parallel. And secondly, you want asynchronous fetching, so send off the query, send off the query, send off the query, send off the query, and then asynchronously consume data as it comes in. Okay, so that's something you need. Of course, this will be in some future version of Postgres. But that's key, you have to make things work in parallel. So 9.6 cannot do this test out of the box. It needs a bit of patching to get it done. So they put everything in there, and that's fine. So for future of Postgres, this looks very bright, because most of the stuff is basically on the way, right? Postgres 10. Then comes something really nasty. Normally, so in the Postgres versions you are using, So it's a two-class society. I got a better version than you. Normally what you do is that aggregations happen before joins and append and all this kind of stuff. Because usually if you take an old traditional plan, there is no aggregate down here, it's up there. Right? So this is gonna fetch the data, aggregate it. And the key to success is really to get this aggregate down here into the other side. And that is nasty. That is really, really nasty. That needs some patching, which we did. Actually, there are two patches out there. I think one was published by EDP and the other one by my fellow colleague, Tony Huska. So we basically had to spend some time on patching the optimizer, which is a really, really nasty part here. That's not trivial to get it done. To actually do the aggregation before you add it up again. So if this append node in between. That's, Joe is already looking scared. Are you? He knows the implications, right? Okay, so this is not trivial to do that. But as I said, it was for American conference, and we are people from Europe, so we wanted to show that we have technology over there. Okay, so that's also, that's key. That's really key, because in order to make aggregates shard all over the place, you have to make the aggregations on the other side. And if something like that, it doesn't mean that our patch has to make it into core. If any patch providing this functionality makes it into core, this is going to be the real key milestone in order to have insanely distributed computation. Okay? Because everybody does its work, you add up the answers, everybody is fine. Some people call it MapReduce style aggregation. Okay, if you want to use that term for whatever reason. So that's important. I can't stress it enough. So, of course, if you do something like an average, or if you do some more complicated thing, I mean, if you do an average locally, you add up the numbers, you count the stuff, and at the end of the day, you divide, right? So final function is going to divide. You can't do that anymore, because if 32 nodes are going to send you an average, you cannot average the average. It's not correct, right? It's not going to give you the same answer. It's going to give you roughly the same answer, but roughly the same answer is only okay in politics, right? So we are in database business. We're insanely conservative people, at least on the data side. And of course, therefore, bad English. I got this horrible Schwarzenegger accent, isn't it? I'll be back. Or the query is terminated. Have you seen that they come from the same area as Schwarzenegger? Would you have guessed? No. Austria? Yeah. Have you heard about it? Yeah. It's not Australia, no kangaroos, but you can eat kangaroos. We've tried that. So over there, easy extension, you put in some extension to have those partial results coming over. So I cheated a bit. What you've seen here is not the standard Postgres count. It's my count. But don't worry, it's no fake news. It's real data. So it's really going to work. Okay? So bottom line, dissect the aggregation, send the parallel stuff, execute on the stuff, add on the main node, be happy. Okay? That's the whole thing. So here it is. For €28.14, so two coffees at the airport. Here's the query, and what you see is it's roughly 3.2 billion lines, so each shard is 300 something million. And here we are in 2.9 seconds, okay? To the tune of 16 times 32 times 16 cores. Which is something which can be improved on, which is basically the next topic. Any questions so far? Yes, sir.
Probably a joint mistake, but this FP node is a part of data wrapper, can also talk to Oracle and other
products. The foreign data wrapper infrastructure can. We use the Postgres FTW here and apply the patch for that so that it can push down aggregates. Okay, there is a patch which was committed already in 10.0. In order, the interface could already do that before, but the specific part to talk Postgres to Postgres needed to push down the aggregates. Okay, so we also added this part in case I forgot to mention. You could do similar things with Oracle. I don't know by heart if Oracle can already push down aggregates into the foreign data wrapper. Do you happen to know, Joe? Yeah, me too. So we have doubt, my friends. We have doubts. but I know the guy who is also sitting in Vienna, by the way. He has a lot of time to work on foreign data wrapper for Postgres because he's working for city government, bureaucrats, basically. So, but he's a very good guy. You will love him. He's so great. He grabbed the code by the compiler. Yeah. Could happen, yeah.
Do you have any strategies for working around that?
Well, you can basically overrule. You can decrease this this value, this min relation, whatever size, for this particular table. So you could do alt the table on that. So that's one way to do it. And secondly, fix it in core. That's the only strategy I'm aware of. But basically, you could just configure it for this table as you know what's going to happen, right? No, Excel uses a different strategy here. We really tried to go as vanilla as we could, to use as much standard Postgres as possible, no external stuff, no magic, whatever. So I really want to give you an outlook what should be possible with standard Postgres without using a code fork, without using a commercial product, without doing anything. So the point is really, for me, so I hope I got it across. To really do as much as standard Postgres as possible to see what are the missing parts to do things like that done. Of course, there are solutions out there, Greenplum, which does its stuff, Excel, which does its stuff, some other stuff, which does its stuff. So I was short on names. I couldn't remember anything else. Citus was one. Okay, so everybody's doing his own stuff here. But this is really as down to Postgres core as we would potentially get. Okay? So, as I said, €28.14. You were really worth it. Thank you very much. As I said, a lot more parallelism in Postgres 10. There was a blog post out the other week by Robert Haas, and it had so many items on it that I can barely remember what it all was. There was so much work going into Postgres parallelism for 10 and beyond. So this is going to be, I would say, a game changer in this field. But let's do a word of caution. What you've seen is a trivial query. You're counting numbers. That's not too hard. Let's try the same with rollup, group, grouping sets, windowing functions, things like that. Within group, order, etc. Game over. Okay? Game over. That simple. Rollup. If you have rollup means male, female, total, right? It gives you this summary line. So all the states, all of US, right? That's rollup. It requires sorting. Try to sort something across 32 shards without moving data around. I would say not in 3 seconds, okay? There is something on the way, I think, to make this work with hashing as the normal query, but basically, what I'm trying to say is that it's not going to work for an arbitrary query, okay? So it's wonderful for min, max, things like that. That's easy. But if you go for a median, for instance, that's not so trivial anymore. It's a bit nasty. Or if you go for windowing functions over order by partition, okay? things starts to be fishy. So there's a long, long way to go in order to have a larger subset of SQL working on this amount of data. Okay? So as I said, try to get there, see how far we are from a practical use case, typical data crunching, average, count, sum, whatever. Okay, and let's see what's needed to go from there. But I wanted to say is if anybody has the impression that, hey, cool, we're just three patches away from scaling anything to a billion rows, okay, that's not the case. That's not the case. So this is something which is partly theoretically not possible, and partly it's going to be a couple of years in the future. Okay, so this has to be straight. This has to be stressed, okay, so that really this point comes over. Okay, how things are gonna speed up? I've seen on the to-do list of the Russians that I think they're free. What? What is funny about Russia? that three teams, I think, one in Germany, heard of Germany? Yeah, nobody heard of Germany?
Oh. West from Russia.
Yeah, West from Russia, yeah. Yeah, West from Russia, yeah. West of Berlin was I had relatives in Germany. My ex-wife was German, and always told them, if you build a wall, build it behind you, not in front of you. Right? Never got through. So just-in-time compilation. So I think there are three teams out there who are working on different approaches for just-in-time compilation. There is one team in Russia, I forgot the name, is something, Russian team. There's also somebody southwest of Germany who's doing different approaches. So what you're going to see here is for this kind of query, there is a lot of potential in Postgres to do this with fewer than 500 cores. Okay, so if this is really nicely compiled, etc., we might be able to do it in 100 cores, right? So, which means not 30 machines, but 6, okay? Assuming that we have enough memory, okay? So this is gonna really, really gonna rock big time once we got it in order to speed up this kind of analytics, okay? So that's really, really important stuff going on. The second thing here is, which could be possible, I was short of some other word here, deeper execution. Short of English, that was the main issue here. At this point, there was one node, then some aggregation, that's it, right? But for some calculations, you might go deeper. You might have a tree. Something's going to happen here. Something is going to happen on the next stage. Something's going to happen on the next stage. So that you basically funnel the whole thing into a system across multiple servers, okay? If you do some trickery with views and things like that, it would basically already be possible with what we got here. We did some experiments for some gearbox detection, error detection stuff. It's basically already possible to have nodes feeding into nodes or have some sort of pipeline out of servers. So that's something which is certainly gonna be interesting to examine in the future. And then, of course, there's this huge thing called column store. Right? The point here is that currently Postgres stores rows, okay? And if you want to have the fifth column, you have to go through it and fetch it, and maybe you don't even need the first three, okay? So for many of this kind of workloads for time series, etc., it's a lot easier to store things as columns because there's usually a lot more redundancy in a column than you have in a line, right? So if you have time, the next line might be 2 seconds ahead, and the next one is 3 seconds and 2 seconds, etc. So you might only want to store the deltas and not the whole thing. So there's a lot more redundancy in a column usually than you got in a line. Okay? And if you only need 3 columns out of 50, right? Column store is a big deal for this kind of workloads. Huh? So it's also going to reduce CPU consumption dramatically, okay, in the future, as soon as somebody figures out how to implement it the best way. There is a lot of stuff out there. It's contrib extension, but it doesn't work with parallel query. There are forks, etc. There's a lot of stuff. But the aim is clear. It's I think everybody is sufficiently aware of the notion that this is going to boost analytics, because that's what it does, vectorization, etc. Okay, so any questions regarding the whole thing? Yes, sir.
Oh, with regards to the pushdown of the aggregates?
Yeah.
What if my aggregate contains a subselect based on a case statement? Does it do the actual subselect first on the master node and then push down the actual values?
If you can show me the query, I can tell you. And if a subselect in the count,
correct.
Why do you want to do that?
Okay, but why not?
Oh, why not? I can tell you a couple of reasons, because maybe you don't want to do it for every row. Maybe there is a better way to formulate that.
Okay.
More questions? Yes, sir. Well, there are two ways to approach the problem. Let me start with the inconvenient answer first. If you are in warehousing, analyzing historic data, there's not going to be coming sales data or temperature from yesterday. So one approach is, I'm not saying that I'm for that. I'm just saying that that's a philosophy which exists. Put it that way. So in this case, you might not even care that this is the case, that you don't see the same snapshot on all the servers. At this point, given this approach, there is no guarantee. There is a guarantee that you have 32 or 33 separate transactions going on. And MVCC or whatever ensures that every shard in itself is consistent. But there is no such thing as a global snapshot, because they are all in different transaction IDs. They're all doing different. Basically, what you do is it's just like Googling three websites. They have nothing to do with each other, but you got the feeling that the data is accurate. Okay, there is no global transaction manager involved here. And that's a major difference to some other approaches. Right, so there's no thing. But again, when Postgres opens the, you plan the stuff, you're in a certain transactional view, and then basically all those snapshots get opened pretty much at the same time. So it's not guaranteed to be precise, but it's, for analytical stuff, in many cases, good enough, I would say. Okay? So, next one.
The column, the last one that you were talking about, the column, would it be an option on the table that you would create, or by default it would be column?
Postgres default is always row. It's always row.
So it will stay?
Didn't say that. There is a CStore extension for Postgres, but it's we haven't done it with parallel queries. Okay. Cool. Any more questions? Okay. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope you liked it. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, tell all your friends about us, and I'll be back.